Hey, will you pray with me? Father, we sing hallelujah here below because you are worthy of all the praise. If you never did another thing, you've already done enough. God, we're broken people, and you don't need anything from us, God, but you delight in the offering that we bring. And so, God, we make ourselves available to you today. God, we're open to what you have to say and how you want to speak into our lives. And God, may our response be a hallelujah with our life, that we would obey you and love you and treat people in such a way that would be pleasing to you. So God, thank you so much for loving us. God, thank you for bringing us to a place where we can safely gather as the church. And God, right now, I just lift up my brothers and sisters in Afghanistan who are in hiding, who are suffering, fear of their lives. God, would you give them a peace that doesn't even make sense? Would you somehow rescue, as we know you can do? But God, if it ends in a way we don't want, may you be forever praised. May you somehow get glory, what the enemy meant for evil. God, use it for good. We love you so much, and we thank you for who you are in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody believed it, said? Everybody said? Hey, say hi to somebody next to you. Thank you for being in church today. Come on. Yeah, hey, welcome. Hey, welcome to Renovation Church. I want to say a special welcome to everybody watching online and all of our first-time guests in the house. Come on, church, make them feel welcome. Thank you for being here today. So excited. And today we are in week 3 of a series that we've entitled Blockbusters, where we're taking some of the best movies ever made, and we're going to God's Word and teaching through them. And for some of you, you may be wondering why in the world we've done this, and I've explained it every week, but I'll say it again. The reason we're doing this is because Jesus taught in parables. He told stories in such a way where he would use cultural examples to help illustrate who he was and what he came to do. And so over the past couple of weeks, we've taken a look at a couple movies, the first week being The Sandlot. Any Sandlot fans in the house? Come on. Last week, we were doing Karate Kid, and we did The Crane. Come on, somebody. But today is a special day, and I'm excited about it. It's Disney Sunday, and we got kids downstairs dressed up as their favorite Disney characters. And today, as you probably see us promote, we're going to be taking a look at one of the most popular movies of all time, the number one animated movie of all time. And there's really only one way that I think we can really introduce this movie and kick it out, the movie being The Lion King. Oh, I had to. Sorry, I'm stupid. My bad. Love you. All right. Anyway, had to have a little fun with that. It's the only way we could do it. Y'all give it up for my son, Jet. Come on, somebody. Anyway. Sorry, I just had to take the liberty. Okay, let me zone back in here. But today we're talking about Lion King. The original movie came out in 1994, and so I'm going to unpack the movie. And you can't get mad at me, okay, if I ruin it for you. You've had like 27 years to watch the movie. There is a new movie that came out in 2019. In fact, a lot of people are like, oh, I don't like the 2019 version, but the 2019 version is the number one animated movie of all time, grossing over $2 billion in income. Obviously, that's only because the first movie in 94 was so great. And so together, these two movies grossed over $2.6 billion, making them the number one animated movie of all time over Frozen and Frozen 2 of all movies. Let it go. All right. And so if you haven't seen this movie, right, the Lion King is about a young lion that's going to become king. It's real simple. But this at the beginning of the movie, as you see Rafiki hold up Simba and present him to the animal kingdom, and all of the animals are going crazy and they're excited. And then Mufasa, his dad, the current king, is going to then teach him how to become king. And as he's teaching him how to roar and all that stuff. And eventually he goes back and he finds himself hanging out with his uncle, Scar, Mufasa's evil brother, as you would say. And he has this conversation with Scar and he says, my dad says that I'm going to be king. And I'm going to be king over you. And what does that make you? He's like, I guess it means I'm a monkey's uncle, you know? And he's frustrated. You can tell he's bitter. He's irritated. He's not about it. And so then he does something interesting. He says, you know, Have your father showed you the whole kingdom? He said, yep, I've seen all of it. And he says, even over there. And he says, well, what's over there? And he's like, oh, no. That's the place where only the bravest lions go, the elephant graveyard. And as you can imagine, being a young cub, he gets curious. And so he gets his friend Nala, who we'll talk about a little bit later. And him and Nala go into the elephant graveyard, and they're there, and they meet the three hyenas who then try to take them out and kill them in the elephant graveyard. And all of a sudden, Mufasa comes in, saves them, pins down the hyenas, and sends Nala and Simba home. They're in big trouble. And then you kind of fast forward a little bit, and he finds himself hanging out with Scar again. But this time, Scar took him down into what's known as the gorge, and he tells Simba that he has a surprise for him and his dad, a little father-son gift. And they tell Simba to stay there. And as he leaves the gorge, he gives the hyenas a signal to then attack the wildebeest, which leads into the great stampede where Simba runs for his life. Finds himself up on a tree, and Scar runs up, and he tells Mufasa that Simba is down in the stampede. And so, like a good father, Mufasa comes down, and he saves his son, and he gets him off the tree and throws him up on the ledge. And then he himself, it seems as if he's going to die, and then he jumps out of the herd, and he starts to climb the mountain, and then the movie ends. No. Climbs out of up the hill, and all of a sudden you see Scar, his brother, lock his claws into him, and he cries for help, and Scar looks at him, and his eyes turn all yellow, and he says, long live the king, and throws him into it, and as you know what happens next, Mufasa dies, and I'm going to show you that clip now. I'm kidding. Don't do that. You're like, what? That would be so manipulative of me. I had to play a joke. Okay. Of course we're not going to watch this. The saddest thing forever. It ruined your childhood. The movie shouldn't have been rated G. Anyway, I still kind of like get teary-eyed when I watch that scene. And as you know, Simba, he finds his dad who had been killed, and he comes up and he's crying and he's upset. And then Scar shows up again on the scene, and he says, the king is dead. And he wouldn't have been dead if it wasn't for you. And then he says, what would your mom think? And you see the fear in Simba's eyes where he begins to believe that it was his fault, that he had killed his father, that he was responsible. And he says, well, what do I do? And he says, run, Simba. Run far away and never return. And so, as you know, the premise of the movie, Simba runs away from home carrying all of this guilt and all of this shame. And as he gets out of the kingdom and he begins to leave home, he runs into two really interesting characters named Timon and Pumbaa. Check this out. Hey, online audience, thanks for tuning in with us today. I want to encourage you, hey, share the stream. I think this is going to be a really powerful message. But I'm coming to you because, as you know, we're in Blockbusters and we're showing some different clips that we can't show due to copyright issues. And so Simba, he leaves home after the death of his father, Mufasa, with all this guilt and with all this pain, and he runs away. And as he's out there, he meets Timon and Pumbaa. And as he meets Timon and Pumbaa, they introduce him to their motto, to their philosophy on life, Hakuna Matata, right? It means no worries for the rest of your days. And so right now you probably can sing the song. It's one of the most popular songs ever written. Everybody knows it. But right now that song is being sang, and Pumbaa's talking about when he was a young warthog and all of the things that happened and how his friends wouldn't sit downwind and all this stuff. And then you see young Simba kind of join in on Hakuna Matata. And it's this philosophy that he's introduced to, this different way of thinking, right? That means no worries for the rest of your days. And so the reason I share that and I wanted to show this clip today is because I think that there are some implications from it that you and I can really learn when we experience pain and we experience guilt and we experience shame. And our natural tendency really is to try to figure out how to overcome it or move on or get past it or heal from it. And we tend to run, and then there's this idea that you can live life problem-free, no worries. And so what I want to talk about is that even possible? Is it true? Go back inside and check it out. Come on, y'all better sing it, Hakuna Matata. I was hoping y'all were in here singing. I was backstage talking to our online family. But Hakuna Matata, right? What a wonderful phrase. Means no worries for the rest of your days, right? Like, we love the song. We sing the song. We know it by heart. It's one of the most famous songs ever written. And I love the song, right? I love the motto. I love the sentiment behind it, that you can just kind of have this like life full of no worries. But though Hakuna Matata is a great song, how many of you know that singing a cute song won't take away the shame that you feel? Like if you're going to deal with the pain and you're going to deal with the problems in life in your past, it's going to take more than a motto. It's going to take more than a cute song you can sing that will make you feel better in the moment. Right? Like it's this idea of living with no worries. And I guess my question is that like it's a catchy tune, but is it even possible? I mean, it's a great philosophy to have, but can it actually be reality? Like can I live a life where worry doesn't consume our mind? Where the problems we've faced and the pain we've experienced doesn't just take over and direct and cause us to do different things and live certain ways. It doesn't control all of our life. Is that even possible? And what I would tell you is that singing Hakuna Matata, it will not make all your problems go away. But I do think that you can live a life not consumed by worry or consumed by pain, but write this down. Running away from the problem doesn't solve it. Running away from the problem doesn't solve it. Running away from the pain doesn't heal it. Like there has to be some type of process. And I think that for many of us, this is how we have learned to deal with our pain. And so I just want to know who I'm preaching to and who this sermon is today. How many of you have ever experienced the guilt and the regret of a bad decision or the shame over something that has happened to you? Can I see a show of hands? All right, I just want to know who I'm preaching to. So we're all on the same page. And so what that means is the truth is everything about your life and my life, we've all been through some stuff. We've all experienced pain. Many of us have experienced loss to someone that we love. We've all done some things and made some mistakes and made some choices that we're not proud of. And all of us, I think it's safe to assume, none of us have always handled it the right way all the time. All of us have like felt this need to maybe run and figure out some way, go somewhere, change locations, do something different in order to get over the pain from our past. And I want to start here because why is that? Like what I've figured out in my life is the natural tendency when we feel guilt and when we feel shame is to run and to hide and try to cover it up. And the reason why that's your tendency and mine when we go through things is because when you go back to the beginning in Genesis 3, when sin entered into the world, when Adam and Eve ate the mango, okay, some of you are like, mango? Yeah, an apple is not enticing enough to ruin the world, okay? So I think it's a mango. We'll talk about that later, but so they eat the mango and sin enters into the world. And what happens is it says their eyes were opened and they realized they were naked and felt shame. That they were exposed. And the response to shame was, what did they do? They ran and they hid and then they covered themselves with fig leaves. Now, I know that you don't cover yourself with fig leaves today, but we still cover ourselves with fig leaves all the time. Today, they just look different. Today, it just looks like money. Like for some of you, when you experience pain and you experience hurt and you don't really know how to deal with it, what you think is that if I can just like go to work and my head is just to the grindstone and I'm working hard and I put in more hours and I make more money and I provide for my family, that somehow will make that pain go away. It's success. And thinking, well, I may be going through some things, but like at least I've got this other stuff going on over here. For some people, it's humor. It's why you see so many comedians that will come out later on in their life, people who have made a living off of making other people laugh only to learn that they were depressed deep down on the inside. Because if I can get you to laugh, I don't actually have to talk about what's going on in here for me. And I don't know what it looks like for you. I don't know what you run to. It may be pills. It may be a blunt. It may be alcohol. It may be a relationship. It may be a job. But the truth is all of us have ran to the wrong thing to try to find healing. We've all made that mistake. And the tricky part about it is that all of those things aren't bad. And I don't know what it is for you. I know for me, I remember being as a kid when my parents got divorced at a young age, the way that I dealt with kind of having to split time with my parents was that I just focused a lot on sports. And there's nothing wrong with sports. I love sports. Go Titans. Come on, somebody. But like, I'm praying for the Vols. We're going to do something different this year. If you're a Bama fan, it's okay. This might not be your church. All right, anyway. you're welcome here, I promise. We're just going to get you saved. Anyway. So I love sports, but like I spent all of my time not dealing with the pain. And I just focused on like, if I just play sports and I consume my life with basketball and with baseball and with football, I won't actually have to deal with what's going on at home. And some of you can relate. It was as I grew up and I lost my grandmother who helped raise me as a young kid at times. And as I lost my brother to cancer at the age of 15, I became frustrated with God and I didn't know how to process and I didn't know what to do. And so sports then wasn't enough. And so then I started to try to hook up with girls and just do that whole thing on the weekends. And then that didn't become enough. And so then I started drinking and over and over and over. And I was trying to figure out, how do I deal with it? You ever been there? Where you're just going like, what do I do? Like, and we've all made that mistake. We've ran to the wrong thing and ran away and did the same things. It's why so many people will change cities thinking if I just move locations, I can create a new me. Because no one really knows who I am. And so now I can kind of put on this new identity as you see in Lion King where Simba runs away and now he kind of gets to start this new life. It's why people, when they get frustrated or with someone at church, they'll just change churches. Or when you actually get involved and you actually start going to group and you realize and you start to open up about what's going on in your marriage or in your family or what you've been through or the mistakes you've made and somebody doesn't receive it the way you hoped, it's just easier than to deal with it to run from it. And I'll just go to a different church. I'll just start over. It for others of you, it's a job. Like I don't know what it is, but we've all done that. We've all had to run away to something. And here's what I'll tell you. Running away from your problems doesn't solve them. Like hiding won't heal it. So you and I, we have to decide like what are we gonna do with the pain that we're carrying? And here's what I would say. If that's you today and you're here and maybe that's what you're doing right now. Maybe you just moved to this city for that very reason. Maybe you just switched jobs. Maybe you came to church because there are some things you're trying to work through. You've tried everything else, and you're just hoping that maybe coming into church, you'll get some sort of solution that will help you in life. And here's what I would say. If that's you, there is no shame in being here. And I want you to know that no matter what it is you're carrying, no matter what sin you're struggling with, no matter what you bring in today, no matter what you've been through, no matter what you've done, that this is a place you can belong before you believe. This is a safe place you can come in. And so there is no shame because the truth is everybody raised their hand and said, I've been there, I've done that. And you know, so as this movie unravels, there's some things I want to learn from it. There's some things that I think you and I can get out of it. But more importantly, there's a parable that Jesus teaches. And it's a parable, a story like the one you just watched, right? Like a one you're probably, many of you like The Lion King, are really familiar with. And it's a story about a father who had two sons. And we, as I watched this movie, Luke chapter 15 just popped into my head and into my heart. And I was like, man, what a great illustration of the parallels in this movie. And so here's what I want to do. I want to go to Luke chapter 15, and I want to take a look at it, and I want to read it. And I believe that Jesus is going to really speak to you today, and he's going to help you kind of address some of the baggage you may be carrying and how the father then views you. So Luke chapter 15. If you're ready for the word of God, somebody shout, I'm ready. Ready. All right, here we go. Luke 15. We're going to start in verse, let's start in verse 11. Let me read the whole. It's going to be a little bit long, so lean in with me. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. And let me give you some context. Here's a father. He has two sons. Why two sons? Well, if you go back and you read Luke 15:1, what you'll find out is that who Jesus is talking to is a crowd of people, much like the crowd today. And in the crowd, it said that there were religious leaders and notorious sinners. Not secret sinners like some of us, notorious sinners. And so who Jesus was talking to is these two kind of different crowds. And in this crowd were religious leaders. So we just gonna pretend like you're the religious leaders and there were notorious sinners. You're gonna be the notorious sinners, okay? And you'll be like, that's me. And then some of you, y'all gonna be the teachers over here. And so if you look at the picture, Jesus is going, okay, I'm gonna tell you a story about two sons. And you're gonna fall really into one of two categories. And so for everybody over here, you're the religious teacher. So picture, he's talking to preachers and prostitutes. I know you've been a prostitute. It's okay. But he's talking to teachers and drug dealers. That's the audience he's talking to. And what he's trying to get them to understand, he's like, I'm going to tell you a story about a father with two sons because all of you fit into one of these two categories. And the truth is some of you are here today and you're going, yep, that's me. I'm a notorious sinner. These people made their living off of doing things illegal. There were people who, they knew they were bad. For some of you, that's you. You're like, I know I'm lost. I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing is wrong. I know I need to change. That's for some of you right now, that's where you're at. But then there's the other group of people that go, you know what? I'm not that bad. I mean, I go to church. I was raised in church. I know the Bible. Like, I'm good. Like, I'm not as bad as them over there, but like, I got issues. I'm good. And what Jesus is trying to get them to understand is that both people need Jesus. This story is not a story about one prodigal son who runs away. This story is about two prodigal sons that don't know the Father for who he is. And so let's continue reading. The younger son told his father, I want my inheritance. J.G. Wentworth, I want my money and I want it now. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land where he wasted all his money in wild living. About that time, his money ran out and a great famine swept over the land and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him and the man sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. Now, this is one of the most disgraceful, like rock bottom jobs that this boy could get. And the reason why was because he was Jewish. And if you know anything about Jewish culture, they didn't mess with pigs. They didn't eat pork. And so out of everything he did, he goes out, he spends and he blows all his money. And now he has a job working and feeding the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding Pumbaa looked good to him. But no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I'll go home to my father and say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant. And so he returned home to his father. And while he was a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he comes up and he embraces him and he kisses him and he said, Father, I've sinned against both heaven and I've sinned against you and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But then it's like the father interrupts him. He says, quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on and bring a ring and put it on his finger. Bring him some J's and strap them to his feet and kill the calf that we've been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and now has returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So the party began. How many of you love that scripture? We're not finished. Meanwhile, the older son, he was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house. And he asked one of the servants, what's going on? So the music, not just the music and dancing was so loud here. I don't know if y'all have ever been to a party, but if you can hear dancing, that mug is turned up, all right? I mean, they're stomping, right? And they says, what's going on? Your brother's back and your father has killed the fattened calf. We're celebrating because of his safe return. The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came and begged him, but he replied, all these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to do. And all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet, when this son of yours comes back, after squandering his money on prostitutes, you celebrate by killing Bessie, the fattened calf. His father said to him, look, dear son, you've always stayed by me and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found. I love what Tim Keller says. He says, the purpose of this parable is not to warm our hearts, but to shatter our categories. That so often we come into a place and we have categories that we place everybody in. You're either a notorious sinner or you're a religious drug dealer, you're a religious Pharisee. It's like you're good and I'm bad, and we have all these categories. And what Jesus is doing, he's like, no. Both roads lead to a dead end. And so what happens, right? The younger son comes to him, verse 12, and he says, Dad, I want my money and I want it now. What he was saying was, Dad, I wish you were dead. I don't know about you, but if I said that to my father, there are going to be some problems. Not only would it hurt his feelings, he's going to hurt my butt. Dad, I wish you were dead. Like, I want your inheritance. I want the blessing. See, what we learn in this part of the story is that his heart was already separated from the father before he ever got the inheritance. Because he didn't want the father, he wanted what the father had. He didn't want the blesser, he wanted the blessing. He didn't want the provider, he wanted the provision. And so he's got, I want my money and I want it now, give it to me. And then look how gracious the father is, even though his heart is in the wrong spot. It says, so then he divided the wealth between the two. See, in Jewish culture, the oldest son would have gotten 2/3 of the wealth, the youngest one would have gotten 1/3. And even though the motive was wrong, the ask was wrong, the request was wrong, the father gave it anyway. Can I just tell you, sometimes God will answer prayers that you should have never prayed. Sometimes God will give you things that you want so that when you get them, you'll see how desperate you really need him. Like, some of you know what that's like. Like, you used to pray for that boyfriend or girlfriend back in the day, and then you got him and you're like, oh crap, shouldn't have prayed for that. But sometimes it's the job you prayed for, then you got, and you had an evil boss that was manipulative and lying and trying. You're like, oh, I used to pray for that. I used to ask for that, but that's not actually what I needed. See, God will give you what you want in order to show you what you really need. And see, there's things in your life that you're asking God for, and he'll let you have it, not to harm you, but to teach you that apart from him, it's not going to be what you think. It's not going to be the life you live. And see, a lot of times, y'all, like, we want the inheritance, but we don't realize that the inheritance the Father gives is the Father. We want the provision, not realizing that the provision we desperately need isn't more stuff, but a Savior. And so we have to go, you know what? I'm going to go, hey, this isn't what I need. But the tendency, y'all, is to just run away and believe that life outside of the Father is better. Isn't that what this boy believed? He believed that, you know what, my life here at home in my father's house won't be as satisfying as what's out here in the world. And what we read then is we read this list of words of what it looks like to live outside of the presence of the Father. Like, if we were to go back and read it, and I'm going to save some time here, I'm just going to point out a couple of things that I saw. Here's some words that is described at the young man when he's apart from the father: distant, wasted, ran out, broke, starving, famine. Some of you are hearing this, you're like, that describes my life, that describes my marriage, that describes how I'm feeling. He was eating and hanging out with pigs. Some of you are like, that sounds like the last guy I dated, right? Like, you know what it's like, right? This is what life looks like outside the father. And sometimes it looks right and it looks good and it feels good, but it's not what you need. And let me just go ahead and save you a lot of time, and some of you will back me up because this is your testimony, that you may get what you want, but if you're outside of the Father's presence, it will never be what you truly need. And what happens, y'all, is so many people live here. They get the blessing. You get your dream job. You get your money. You have the house. You have the pretty family photos with the little dog that smiles too. You know what I'm talking about? And what happens is you live there and then you realize that actually didn't fix anything. Why? Because running from the problem doesn't solve it. Covering it up and hiding it doesn't heal it. And so as the story goes on and Simba's trying to figure out what he's going to do, and he's living it up, right? He's hanging out with the pig. eating his food, just enjoying life, no worries, singing Hakuna Matata. All of a sudden, his past catches up with him. His past has now grown up, and her name is Nala. Nala comes, and she tells Simba something. She says, Simba, the kingdom is suffering because you're not in it. That there is a famine in the whole land. And because you're not stepped up as the king, your uncle Star has stepped up as the king. And now everyone is suffering. You have to come home. And let me just say this. The kingdom is suffering because some of y'all ain't in it. Your family line is suffering because some of you have ran away and you're trying to cover your pain and you think that it's going to make you better and you've gotten all the success, but some of your family is suffering because you haven't taken the role in your family to bring healing to it. Like some of you have to decide, you know, I'm going to step up. I'm not going to hide it. I'm not going to run from it. I'm going to have to face it in order to heal from it. And if you don't, what happens is the king, the culture of this world, begins to take over and people start to live and believe the lie that if I had that out there, then I would be good. And it's a lie that I've believed. It's a lie that you've believed. And if you're not careful, if you don't take your place in the family of God, in your identity as a son and daughter, this next generation rising up will believe the same lie that so many of us believed. And so he has a decision to make. Is he going to go home or is he going to hide? Check the second clip out. Hey, online family, thank you so much again for being here. And obviously, we're in our second scene now. And Nala has just come back, and she has talked to Simba. And she's trying to convince him, like, hey, come back home. We need you. The kingdom needs you. The kingdom is suffering. And he's like, no, I can't do that. Like, they would never accept me. They would never welcome me back. And he's kind of wrestling with what to do. And all of a sudden, this monkey shows up, Rafiki. And he's saying, Asanta Sana, squash banana, and kind of getting on his nerves and trying to convince him, like, hey, will you come back? Like, I know who you are. You don't even know who you are. And he's like, what do you mean I don't know who I am? He's like, you're a buffoon. He's like, I think you're confused. He's like, no, you're confused. You don't even know who you are. He's like, I know who you are. You're Mufasa's boy. And he says, I don't know if you know this, but my father's actually dead. And he said, no, he's not. Follow Rafiki and he'll show you the way. And so Simba begins to kind of go And Rafiki makes him go to this pond. And in this pond, he's looking and staring at his reflection. And he looks down and he sees himself. And he's like, no, that's just me. That's just my reflection. He says, no, look again. And it's that famous scene where he looks down into the water. And all of a sudden, he sees his father's face. And then the storm kind of comes and it gets dark. And his father talks to him and says, Simba, you've forgotten who you are. You've forgotten, like, who you are and whose you are, and you've forgotten, like, what you're called to do. And so he says, remember who you are. And so we're going to go right back in just a second and talk about it. Remember who you are. Write that down. Remember who you are. I know that's an obvious point, but it's critical in your walk with Jesus. You got to remember who you are. What happens in the story of the prodigal son is he's there, he's starving, he's in famine, he's eating with the pigs, and it says all of a sudden he comes to his senses. But then he thinks an interesting thought. He thinks, you know what? I'm going to go home to my dad, but I got to come up with this speech. I got to come up with this apology that, like, I hope is good enough. And that maybe, just maybe, because I'm no longer worthy to be called your son, maybe my dad will take me back as his servant. And what I want to tell him and tell you is remember who you are. You are not your past. You are not your pain. You are not your guilt. You are not your shame. You are not a mistake. You're not an accident. You got to remember who you are. You are a child of God. You are a son. You are a daughter. You are loved. You are valued. You are adopted. You are the head. You're not the tail. You are loved by God so much so that he would spend his whole life proving to you, showing you how much he loves you, and would go to a cross, die, resurrect from the grave just to remind you of who you are and who you really belong to. But you got to remember who you are. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to somehow come up with a good enough apology to, like, make God like you or love you or accept you back into his family just because you ran away. Because listen, your identity is not your issues. Your status isn't a result of your sin. Your identity is in your Father. And what I know about him is he is so much better at forgiving than you are at failing. And that what happens is the boy decides to go home. And as he's on the road and he's coming up with his apology, it says that his father ran to him. Can I just tell you that if you will turn and you will go home, your father will run to you. And I love it because it's this picture of like the father isn't in the back room. He's not in some fields like working, not worried about his son. No, it's this picture that he's outside just anticipating his return. Just waiting, and as he tops that hill, the father runs to him and he wraps him in his arms and he kisses him and he hugs him and he says, get his robe back. Let him know who he is. Let him know he belongs to. He was out there and he was scared to death, but I need him to know that he's protected in my house. Give him a ring back. Let him see that he still has authority in my family. Put some shoes on his feet. This guy still has some work to do. And I just came to tell you the same is true for you. That you don't have to come up with some apology. You don't have to get your sins together and clean your life up and think that if I get good enough, I can somehow convince dad to let me back in. No, what he says in that moment as he's preparing his speech, it's like his father interrupts him and he's like, dad, I'm so sorry. He's like, shut up. Hey, quick, get his stuff. No speech necessary because my grace is free and my mercies are new. And you don't have to earn it. You don't got to convince me because you never lost your status as a child. Now you've just come home. So welcome back. Isn't that good news? But you don't have to earn it. And I remember spending so much of my time thinking that I had to get back in God's good graces. And oftentimes what happens is we think that, well, I've messed up. And so now I got to do a bunch of right to outweigh the wrong. And I'm going to talk about that in a second. That's this idea of religion that makes us believe and feel as if when I mess up, God is against me. He hates me, and I have to somehow earn my way back. That's religion. And so we think, you know what? Like, because I'm bad, I'm not deserving of love. But the greater problem is when you think you're good and you deserve everything. This is religion. And so here's what I would say. You gotta go home. We all need Jesus. We all need to be forgiven. We all need to be loved. Whether it was from our self-centeredness or our self-righteousness, Jesus died for both. And so, as we continue and kind of finish out our story, Simba has a decision to make. And today, a lot of you have a decision to make. Are you going to stay in hiding, or are you going to allow God to heal it? Are you going to continue to run away from the problem and away from the pain? Or will you run home to the Father? Will you run back to his presence where everything you really need is? And so, check out this final scene. All right, family, hey, we are in our final scene, and this scene is the decision that Simba has to make. Will he go back or not? And he talks about how he's ran from his past, and Rafiki smacks him on his head. He's like, what'd you do that for? He's like, that hurt. He's like, the past can hurt, but the way that I see it is you can either run from it or you can learn from it. What are you going to do? And so he says, I'm going back. Let's finish this out. You know what I'm talking about? Come on. I love Rafiki. He's the man. I love the quote he says. He says, yeah, the past can hurt, but the way I see it is that you can either run from it or learn from it. And I love it. I mean, Rafiki can preach, y'all. You know what I'm saying? That boy can preach. He didn't even know. And I think you have a decision to make. And as Simba goes home, you got to decide, am I going to go back home to the Father? But in the movie, something happens that's interesting. And in the story, something happens. Like when he comes back to the father's ready to party. He's like, let's throw a party. Let it begin. Let's make some burgers. Let's make some steak. And everybody's excited except one person. Everybody's excited when Simba comes home because they think, okay, he's back. He's going to take his place. He's going to take the throne back. He's going to run the kingdom except for one person. Can I just tell you that when you make your return, when you've been the one that has ran far away from God, just be ready everybody ain't gonna celebrate it. And you know you battle and deal with a religious spirit when someone else's favor frustrates you. Right? Like, I think it happens so much in church, and I've made this mistake, and pastors make this mistake, and people make this mistake, is that we celebrate the stories of people who ran off and were addicted to drugs and were in jail and did all this stuff, and all of a sudden they meet Jesus and they have this radical conversion, and those are the people we highlight, those are the stories we show, because it somehow, it like moves your heart in a different way to think, wow, that could be possible. But can I just tell you, like, the biggest enemy of the gospel is religion. The biggest problem in our county is not people who just ran away and done all that. There's plenty of people, and we want to celebrate and throw a party. But a lot of you in here, that's not your story. Your story is being in the field at home doing everything you're supposed to do. And you think that your testimony has no power because you didn't have that radical transformation. Can I just tell you, from somebody who did go away from home, somebody who did party it up, somebody who did hit rock bottom and battle with depression, I would have wished I'd never had done it. And I think some of us sometimes we like have this swagger about us, like, oh yeah, I used to be this way. No, I wish I didn't go through it, don't you? Because now I got pain that I got to carry that you don't know about. But the truth is you have pain because you felt like you're less important, you don't really matter, that your story can't impact anybody. Well, because you didn't do the drugs and you stayed at home and you grew up in church and you know the Bible and you went to private school and you got the education and you've always just kind of been good. But what might be holding you back is your bitterness. So the older brother, he says, I'm not going into the party. See, comparison will always kill your compassion. And if you're here and you got an issue with having compassion for people who are far from God and who have been transformed by His grace, you may be trapped in comparison. And it'll always kill your compassion. It'll always kill your love for people. It'll mess you up, and you'll never love people the way God wants you to love people. And see, for some of us, our lives have been so defined by our past that we can't step into what God has for us in the future. And let me just say this too. Here's a word. Don't be so consumed by your history when God is more concerned with your destiny. I'll almost say that again. Y'all better wake up. Stop being so consumed by your history when God is more concerned with your destiny. Your past is forgiven. Do you hear me? Somebody needs to hear that today. Your past is forgiven through the blood of Jesus. It doesn't define you. Through the blood of Jesus, that sin is washed away, is cast as far, the east is as far as the west. It's never ending. It's never failing. His love never changes. You don't have to give a speech. It's not necessary because His grace covers a multitude of sins. And while you were yet far off and dead in your sin, Christ died for you. So let's start going, God, I'm not going to just sit back and focus on my history, because you can live there, by the way. But God, I want to know what you have for my destiny. What do you have for me now? You need to go home. But if you're home, listen, it's a blessing that you've gotten to be in the Father's house. Everything He has is yours. You just believed the lie that you had to earn it or deserve it, when the whole time it was free. So don't be bitter when someone far from God comes home, when you see transformation. Don't burn in bitterness. Join the party. Let's celebrate what God wants to do for both the religious and the people far from Him. Hey, will you stand with me? I would love to pray for you as our team comes out, and we're just going to sing this song really quick. And I want to just give you an opportunity for healing to take place right now. Not tomorrow. Like, listen, don't hide it. Don't cover it up. We've all carried a burden. This is the house of prayer. This is where we lay it down. I'm not telling you all your problems will go away. What I am telling you is that when you lay them at the feet of Jesus, there is a peace that surpasses your understanding that you can experience, and you can have peace for your soul and not be consumed by your worry if you will run home to the Father and experience His grace. So God, right now, I pray for everybody under the sound of my voice. I pray that, God, we would run to You, we'd experience Your grace, that healing would happen right now in this room as we praise You and worship You for who You are, knowing that You are in control and that we are loved and that our identity is found in You. We love You so much. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody said, amen.